Good morning, everyone. It's good to see everyone out for worship this morning. Sunday school this morning, we had 40 present. Anybody have a birthday this week? We have any birthday offering this morning? Christmas birthdays? How about anniversaries? Any anniversaries this morning? Had a slew of birthdays. Okay. That was for baby Jesus. All right.
Well, it is good to see everyone out for worship this morning. Like I said before Sunday school, hopefully you had a good Christmas, a time that you were able to think about and reflect about what the Christmas season is. And if you didn't have a good Christmas, it wasn't the weather's fault. It was pretty yesterday. We enjoyed being outside some. Let's stand as we get started this morning. Take time, greet somebody, turn to them, tell them you're glad to see them in the Lord's house this morning.
Be flat, guys.
Thank you.
see all of you. I don't know where the rest of them are, but it's good to see y'all. We're Baptists, Clark. We don't talk about that. Clark said too much eggnog. Anyway, it is a good day to be together to worship the Lord. I hope you all had a really good Christmas. We did, and we appreciate you all as individuals and as a church family for making our Christmas brighter and more merry. We had a lot of people at our house, and we ate a lot of food. And I told somebody else, I'm glad that only happens about once a year. But New Year's is coming, all right? Thank you for coming today. We want to worship the Lord. You know, I was listening to an old preacher the other day, and he said, if you came to church because of the preacher, you came for the wrong reason. If you came to church for the preaching, you came for the wrong reason. If you came to church for the music, you came for the wrong reason. If you came to church to worship God, you came for the right reason. And that's why we're here. And that's where we want to be when we gather. So God bless you. Welcome all of our visitors. Hope you feel comfortable. Let's bow our heads in prayer and invite God into this place and make sure that we're in a place personally where we can hear him. Gary Oaf, lead our prayer, please.
Thank you. Go ahead and be seated. Let's keep singing number 152 in your hymn book. In G, guys. Number 152, if you want to turn over there, we'll sing all of them that we've got. There's not a friend like the Lord.
There's
about number 617 in your hymn book? Just a closer walk with thee. We'll go back to B flat. Number 617 in your hymn book, if you want to look at it. Number 600 in your hymn book, if you want to turn over there. Number 600 in the flat. I don't know. Thank you. Thank you so much for letting us be in your house today, Lord. And as the song said, we don't know what the future has for us, Lord, but we can take comfort in knowing that whatever it has, you've promised to be in there with us. Lord, you said you'd go with us. You take care of all things, and Lord, we know you'll take care of us. Bless those, Father, who are hurting today, who are trying to recover from physical illnesses, Lord, and things that have happened this year, and Lord, I pray that you'll bless those who are just hurting, Father, that need touch from you, Lord. I pray that you'd be very close to them today. Father, help us to fix our eyes on you, Lord. Help us to focus on you, and Father, let the cares of this world just kind of fade away. Lord, we know that if we'll move closer to you, you said you'd move closer to us. Lord, I pray that we'll just do that. As we get ready to finish this year and as we get ready to start another one, Lord, in a few days, that you'll just be the biggest part of it. Lord, bless our time here today. Bless Brother Paul as he preaches. I pray that you'll just help us, Father, to do what pleases you today here. Lord, if somebody doesn't know you as Savior, Lord, I pray that they'll come to that realization today, Lord, that they'll realize that left on their own, that they're a sinner and they're on their way for hell. Lord, just impress them, Holy Spirit, draw them to the fact that Jesus paid that debt for us and we don't have to pay it ourselves. Just go with us, Father. Forgive us of our sin. It's in Christ's name I pray. Amen.
Amen.
All right. This morning, do we have children? Nope, not this morning. All right. Kids, you'll just have to sit by your mom and dad today.
Thank you, gentlemen, for our music. Good today. I'm going to be reading in a moment from the book of Joshua, chapter number 1. If you want to turn there in your Bible, I invite you to do so. It'll also be on the screen in a few moments. I have a rather lengthy introduction to my sermon, but once I get to my points, it'll go fast, all right? I know y'all are thinking he doesn't mean that, but I'm going to work on that. I want you to know. If you start reading the Bible through and you go chronologically, Joshua picks up immediately where Deuteronomy ended. And Deuteronomy ends with the death of Moses. And after Moses died, God ordained, if you will, Joshua. And he had been trained by Moses to be his successor. And so God began to speak to Joshua about leading the children of Israel out of the wilderness, across the River Jordan, and into the land of Canaan, or we know it better as the Promised Land. Well, I've entitled this message, Where To From Here? Because if the Lord stays is coming, and if we're all alive, next Sunday will be a new year. It'll be the first Sunday of 2022. But we have a week left between now and then. And I think it's a good time for us to ponder where we go from here in our spiritual lives. And so that's what this message is about. Now I want to just set the stage a little bit further for you. The children of Israel were camped on the east side of the River Jordan. I see that would be east. The east side of the River Jordan. It was flooded out of its banks. It was that time of year. And Joshua had already announced to them, because God had spoken to him and told him to say to them, you all get ready, because in 3 days we're going to cross that river and we're going to go into that land that God promised us. Now I want to tell you, that was a statement that was almost unimaginable, almost incredible, because the children of Israel had some things that had been working against them greatly. First of all, they had already been here before. About 40 years prior to this, the children of Israel had come to that place and they sent spies into the land and they said, spy it and come back and tell us what the report is. And you remember the story. They sent out 12 spies. The 10 came back and said, there are giants in the land and they're bigger than we are. And they also believe that those giants were bigger than their God was. And the report of the two, Caleb and Joshua, the one we're going to read about this morning, they said, no, there are giants in the land, but we must go up at once now and take it. And they voted on it, and the majority won, but the majority wasn't right. And the punishment, the curse for their not having believed in God was that they were going to wander in the wilderness for 40 years. 40 is a number of judgment in the Bible. Now, they turned an 11-day journey into a 40-year excursion, if you will. They'd been there before. And Joshua says, get ready, because in 3 days, we're going over. And I would imagine that sitting down somewhere in the crowd, there was somebody sitting there. He reminds me of Walter, Jeff Dunham's old man dummy. By the way, I'd like to be him when I grow up, all right? But I can just see him sitting there with his hands folded and said, you're going to do in 3 days what Moses couldn't get done in 40 years? Ha! Never happened, all right? So they'd been there before. Then the second thing they had going against them is that Moses was dead. I mean, Moses, not another like him, according to the scripture. The Bible says that. And here he had, he was God's chosen one to lead them out of the bondage of Egypt, across the Red Sea, the miraculous hand of God. Everything that had been done, and Moses had spoken to God face to face, God just shielded him where he couldn't see his glory, all right? And now Moses is dead. All of the elders of the children of Israel were dead also. All of those 20 years of age and up died in the wilderness because of their unbelief. And Joshua says, now we're going to do it. And this was, they were breaking new ground. This was new territory for them, all right? They're about to embark on a journey that they never, the only ones that had been across that river were the spies. The rest of them had been right there before. Well, I can't go through the rest of the message without stopping and telling you that there are some analogies, there are some comparisons about, listen, leaving Egypt, going through the wilderness, and ending up in the promised land, the land of Canaan. Being freed from the slavery and bondage of Egypt is a picture of our salvation. It is a picture of God's delivering hand upon them. And if you don't know today, you need to know that if you're not saved, you are enslaved to sin. You may be thinking, preacher, I'm not that bad. I'm not as bad as some. But the Bible says that you're a sinner by birth. You've become a sinner by choice. And if you don't do something about it through Jesus Christ, you're going to die in your sins. The bondage of Egypt is a picture of the slavery of the sin. Going through the wilderness, listen,
These people, watch this. These people, the Israelites had been delivered from Egypt. So it's a picture of how they came out. They came out under blood, all right? Can't forget that, amen? They came out under blood. And so that's a picture of their salvation. So these people, according to the analogy, how it relates to us, they were saved. They were believers in God. They were His children. But for 40 years, they lived their life in the wilderness. Saved? Yes. Living in victory? No. Not maturing? No. Just coasting through life with their fire insurance policy in their hand? Yes. They were perpetual babies, never growing up, always griping and complaining about something, never getting from the milk of the Word to the meat of the Word. You want me to preach any more about them? Got wound up. Well, 40 years, that rebellious generation had died off. Now, their children and grandchildren, Joshua says, let's go into this land. Canaan, listen, all the old gospel songs picture Canaan as heaven. Canaan is not heaven. You want to know how I know? I don't have to tell you, but if you want to know, I'll tell you. Because when they got to Canaan, they still had battles to fight. When we get to heaven, there'll be no more battles to fight, all right? Canaan is a picture of the victorious Christian life. Those who are living by the power of God through them and in them, and they experience victory even though they have battles in their life. That's what Canaan is about. And by the way, I want to tell you, everybody here today, you're in one of those three locations. You're either still in Egypt, or you're wandering in the wilderness, or you're living in Canaan, still battling the battles of this life, but by the power of God in you, you experience victory. Whew. By the way, I think there are churches that are like that. I thought about this. I think there are churches that I would classify as Egypt churches. You never hear them preach about salvation by grace, about hell, about sin, because they don't want to offend anybody. They just want everybody to feel good and to smile, and when they leave, say, oh, wasn't that wonderful? Don't we have a great preacher? Egypt churches, you don't ever hear the gospel. The gospel is the power of God and the salvation to everyone who believes. Then there are wilderness churches. And I thought as I penned these notes, how would I describe them? They have saved people going nowhere but in circles. That's what they were doing in the wilderness. 40 years and 11 day journey, and they just wandered here and there, following the cloud, all right? And I know a lot of people like that, and I know a lot of churches like that. Canaan churches, where when you come in the door, you experience the presence and the power of God. It doesn't mean that everyone there is perfect. And if you think you are, you don't belong here. I promise you that. I'm like the old preacher who used to preach here. He said, someday I'd like to come to church and be as good as everyone else thinks I am. We don't think that about ourselves. And I don't think it about most of you, because I know you and you know me. So let's don't go any further. Well, let's read our text, all right? Joshua 1. I told you I had a long introduction, but I did pretty good. Didn't take but 12 minutes. Joshua 1, verses 1 through 13. Now, after the death of Moses, the servant of the Lord, it came to pass that the Lord spoke unto Joshua, the son of Nun, Moses' servant, Moses' minister, saying, Moses, my servant, is dead. Now, therefore, arise, go over this Jordan, thou and all this people, unto the land which I do give to them, even to the children of Israel. Every place that the sole of your foot shall tread upon, that have I given unto you, as I said unto Moses. Now he draws a map for him. From the wilderness and this Lebanon unto the great river, the river Euphrates, all the land of the Hittites, and unto the great sea toward the going down of the sun shall be your coast. And I want to stop right here and say something. If it seems too political to you, I don't care, all right? God drew a map of Israel's land. and they're still fighting over it today. And I want to tell you, God gave them a title deed to it. It's Israel's. And if you can't stand with Israel, I don't think you're going to be very close to God. All right? That didn't cost you anything extra. Verse 5, another promise. There shall not any man be able to stand before you all the days of your life. As I was with Moses, so I will be with you. I will not fail you or forsake you. So be strong and of a good courage, for unto this people you shall divide for an inheritance the land which I swore unto their fathers to give them. Once again, only be thou strong and very courageous, that you may observe to do according to all the law which Moses my servant commanded thee. Do not turn from it from the right or to the left, that you may prosper wherever you go. This book of the law shall not depart out of your mouth, but you shall meditate therein day and night, that you may observe to do according to all that is written. For then you will make your way prosperous, and you shall have good success. Have not I commanded you, third time, be strong and of good courage. Be not afraid, neither be thou dismayed, but the Lord thy God is with thee, whithersoever thou goest. Five principles as you look toward the future, all right? First of all, you, as Joshua, need to understand God's purpose in your life. I know people who live their entire lives and never had any idea what it is God wanted them to do and to be. You need to understand, look at me, God has a plan for your life. It is unique. It is not the plan he has for me. It's not the plan he has for your wife, your spouse, your children, whomever it might be, your friend down the road. God has a unique and distinct plan for your life. Now listen, Joshua had spent his entire life ministering to being Moses' servant. I don't know if Joshua had any idea that the day would come that Moses would die without having gone into the promised land because Moses rebelled against God. I don't think it ever occurred to Joshua at any point in time, hey, one of these days, I'm going to take his place. I don't think it happened that way at all. But God spoke directly, audibly. He doesn't speak audibly to us anymore, but he still speaks to his children through the Holy Spirit, through the Word, whether spoken, preached, read, or listened to, however it might be. But Joshua knew God's purpose. He said to him in those verse 1, he said, Moses is dead. I want you to get up. I want you to go over this river. You and all of these people into the land which I have given them. Purpose. If there's one thing you ought to start thinking about before 2022, is what is it God wants you to do this year? I want to share a story with you. I've shared it with some individuals just in the last few days. I preached a sermon earlier this week at a funeral for a man, and I knew this guy, but I didn't know him well, all right? I just knew of him. But I didn't know about his spiritual condition, and I really didn't have anyone to talk to about his spiritual condition before I did his funeral. So about maybe 10 minutes before this funeral started, I'm standing in the office at the funeral home, and this lady comes up, and if I told you who she was, many of you would know her. She and her husband were at the funeral, of course. And she said, can I talk to you? And I said, sure. So we went back in the little office there, and no one was there. The doors were open, of course. And she said, I want to tell you about the man. I'm not going to mention his name. She said, we've done business with him for a long time, and he's a good man. He always paid on time. He was just a good person, a good person. That's what she wanted to emphasize, all right? But she said, I never knew about his spiritual condition. And she said, he hung out at a business in town, and we did business at that business. And I would always see him there sitting around with all the old men out on the liar's bench, all right? Anyway, she said, I drove in one day, and he was sitting out there, and he was all alone. No one else was there. And she said, the Lord impressed me to go speak to him. And she went and talked to him, and in about 10 minutes, he got saved right there at that business. Listen, that happened in August. He died in December. Here was a person who was so in tune with God that God pointed out to her a distinct purpose in that very moment, and she followed through. God said, Joshua, here's what I want you to do. And Joshua did it. How did he do it? He was believing in the promises of God. Look at verse 11 of the same chapter. We didn't read it. So Joshua commanded the officers. They had them divided up into rank and file, all right? He commanded the officers of the people, saying, I want you to pass through this host. By the way, there were probably 3 to 5 million of them. Yeah, it's astonishing to even imagine that, all right? So I want you to pass through this host of people and command them, saying, prepare you victuals. Y'all know what that means, or do I need to explain that? Y'all are country folk, all right? The word victuals, and if you've never heard victuals, go back and look up Beverly Hillbillies, all right? You'll learn more about victuals there, all right? That's country for food, all right? Get ready. Prepare your victuals, your victuals, for because in 3 days, we're going to cross over this Jordan to go in and to possess the land which the Lord your God gave you to possess. Why in the world did Joshua have enough courage, fortitude, if you will, just plain guts to say to the officers, you go tell them. He didn't go tell them, but he commanded them. God had appointed him the commander of the army of Israel, the leader, the successor. Moses is dead. You're the man, Joshua. Joshua said, you go tell them, you get yourselves ready. In 3 days, we're going over the river. Why? Why? How could he say it? Because he believed the promises of God. All through verses 1 through 9, over and over, he said, as I was with Moses, I will be with you. He said, the promises I gave to Moses are the promises I'm giving to you. He believed in the promises of God. Preparation, prepare you victuals. What's so marvelous about that? Think about this. For 40 years, you know what they've been eating in the wilderness? Somebody tell me. Manna. And one time they got griping about the manna, so they wanted something else, and God gave them quail, which ain't a bad meal, all right? But they got so sick on the quail, the Bible says it ran out their nostrils, and if you need an explanation for that, you need to go back and read it again, all right? But that's all they had. They went out and picked out every morning. It just rained down from heaven, and there it was. And by the way, that's just a picture of God taking care of us. But now Joshua said, you get everything ready because we're going over there and we're not eating it anymore. Because when they crossed over the day, it all ended. Before they went over, they reinstituted the rite of the Passover. They hadn't done it in 40 years of going through the wilderness. They were making preparation. 11-day journey from Mount Horeb to Canaan, but now that's past. God says, get ready. We're going over. Make preparation. I'm going to do through you what never happened to your ancestors. Verse 11 again. Prepare your victuals, for in 3 days you'll pass over this Jordan. There's power in 3 days. There's power in 3 days. Jonah was in the belly of the fish 3 days, but he came out. Jesus was in the belly of the earth 3 days, but he came out. And Joshua said, in 3 days, we're going to cross the river and we're coming out of the wilderness. Why? Because that's the power of God on their lives. I read somewhere, and I'll just share it with you, put it in my notes. Somebody said our challenge is to go to the next level with God. But when we think that, we don't see we have the willpower. Brother Clark mentioned in his prayer this morning that the Bible says that if we'll draw nigh to God, he'll draw nigh to us. And that's true. That's a promise of God. And it's not like God's playing games with us, all right? Draw nigh to God, he'll draw nigh to us. Does that mean if we take a step closer to God, he takes a step closer to us? I guess that's what it means. That's what it says, isn't it? All right? So it's not that God's playing games. Watch this. It means that God is doing business with people who mean business. God pursues us in our salvation, but he wants us to want him in our daily walk, in the lives we live. Immediately we see we don't have the willpower or the personal power that we know we need. And I want to tell you, the problem is you get to that point and so many people just give up in their Christian journey. And they don't realize when they realize they don't have the physical power or the willpower to be who they God wants them to be. They give up and quit, and they're so close to crossing the river into the promised land. And those who do realize you can't do it on your own. I hope you know the rest of the story. 3 days later, the river flooded, and they stepped out into the River Jordan. And what happened to it? Whew. Just like the Red Sea. Can't you imagine how Joshua felt? I mean, God's promised him, as I was with Moses, I will be with you. Joshua said, we're going to cross the river. It's flooded out of its banks, probably as wide as the Red Sea, all right? And they step into it, the priests step into it, the waters part, and they start over on dry ground. Now, if I'd have been Joshua, I'd have said, look here. Yeah, look what God did for Moses. Look what God's doing for me. But it wasn't about him. It was about God. So he's claiming God's promises. He's utilizing God's power. By the way, when they crossed over the river, he said, I want you to get some stones, and I want you to build a monument. One for each of the 12 tribes of Israel. And they put that up, and they said, what does this mean? He said, every time your children, your grandchildren, your great-grandchildren, and down the line, I want you to teach every one of them. This is to memorialize and signify what God did. What God did. It was never, ever about Joshua. By the way, there were 2.5 tribes that didn't go into the wilderness or into the promised land. They chose to stay over on the east side because it was good farmland. People have debated for years, did they make the right choice? Joshua made them promise that we'd go in and help them fight their battles. But they went back over the river. They went on the east side of the river. You know, I have to tell you my own opinion. You can take it, leave it, like it, lump it. It doesn't matter. But I don't think they were living in the promised land. I think they chose gain and materialism over the promises of God. And that's my opinion, all right? Did they come back over and help them fight? Yes, they did. But that's where they chose to settle. Look at me. I know a lot of Christians today who've chosen materialism, fame, gain, fortune, whatever it might be, over going into the promised land, the purpose that God had for them, because they chose to just settle. Becky and I were talking to some mutual friends. Our friends, mutual friends. And this lady was driving to Arizona to attend the funeral for a cousin or an uncle, Becky. Anyway, distant relation. This man was in his 90s. He was an old preacher. Watch this. He was 80 years old, retired, living on a bought farm he owned in Missouri, And God called him to a church in Arizona. He got up, he sold his farm, he packed up his belongings, and he moved to Arizona and pastored that church till he died. Would you do that? Would I do that? I don't know. But I can tell you how come he did if you want to know. He understood God's purpose. He believed in God's promises. He acknowledged God's preparation. He utilized God's power, and he claimed God's provision. Where to from here? I have no idea. But if we'll remember those principles, we'll go with God. Bow your heads, please. We're going to have a prayer in a moment. And as we do, I want you to look into your heart and life, and I want you to ask yourself some questions. Are you ready? Do you know you're ready to meet God? If you've never been saved, you need to be today. As a child of God, where are you? If you're saved, I know you've come out of Egypt. Are you still just wandering in that wilderness, just aimlessly? You don't know God's purpose. You don't know God's plans. You have never acknowledged it. Why don't you do that today? If you'll just get up every morning and say, God, you have a purpose for me today. God might lead you to that person at that business or that home, and you can lead them to Christ so they can get saved. But you've got to be on point to God's purpose. If you're living there, maybe you're going through battles right now. There were battles to fight to gain that land. He said it was yours, but you've got to fight them. Just keep fighting those battles and let God fight for you. I know many of you are struggling with personal battles. There are issues going on in your homes. Many of you are struggling with health issues for you or your family. Some of you have other problems that you've not shared with anybody except those closest to you. I want to tell you, God cares, but you've got to take it to Him. And you've got to leave it with Him. If you need to come pray today as you kneel in the altar, that's a good time and a good place. Some of us need to pray for family members who've strayed away. Maybe you'll do that as God leads you. Heavenly Father, help us to be who you want us to be and do what you want us to do as you guide us. In Jesus' name, I pray. Amen. While we stand together and sing Amazing Grace.
seated, please. Those of you who have been asked to receive the offering, if you'll start coming, we will do that. And while they're coming, I want to mention some prayer requests to you, all right? If you did not get a copy of the printed prayer list, they're out there on the table in the foyer. Please get one. Pray for Miss Carolyn. She's not feeling well. Al wasn't either, but Al's healed. And then Carolyn, but no, I'm sorry.
Erin texted me, and they're not feeling well this morning either.
Okay. Keep praying for Charlie Morton. Charlie's at rehab. They're working him extensively, and he's responding well. He's just getting tired very quickly. But of course, after having been down for almost 4 weeks, it's going to be hard, but he's doing well. Remember our friends Jonelle and Austin Crawley in your prayers. Here's a prayer request I got this morning. Well, here's three that I'm going to add, and I know Donna Spears is on our prayer list, but keep praying for Donna. She's got six more treatments, Randy, six more treatments, so you lift her up in this time. I know how difficult, well, I don't know, but I've heard how difficult it is. All right, I turned that on, sorry. Pray for my cousin, Billy Wilson. He had COVID, and he's having some residual effects from that. And my Aunt Shirley asked for you to pray for him and for them. And also, I got a call from Brother Doyle Barnes. He and Carol's son, Josh, he was playing basketball with some guys, and he fell and broke his arm in 10 places. And he's going to have surgery, but they're praying that they can get the surgery done for before the first of the year for obvious reasons, all right? And so, anyway, y'all pray about that, and I know we've got some people in church that have some ties and trying to help. So who else do you need to mention in prayer? I know there are others on the list that I didn't mention, but who else? A lot of people lost. By the way, just a minute. Thank you, Mary. I'll get right to you before I forget. I talked to Brother Norcellus this past week. Brother Norcellus was supposed to have gone back to Haiti, and he's experiencing some new health issues. Don't know what it is, but he's staying for tests. You probably heard that the other 12 hostages were released from Haiti. That's a lie. They weren't released. They escaped. All right? Liberal media would not give you that truth. I got it from reliable sources. They escaped through an open door, and I'm going to tell you how they knew they were in friendly hands. They heard two men as they made their way across Haiti in the middle of the night playing trumpets, practicing for the church service the next morning. And went to them. They contacted the Coast Guard, and the Coast Guard got them out of there. They weren't released. They escaped. Yeah. Yes, Mary, I'm sorry. If I had told that, I'd have forgot. Okay. Thank you. Did you get... Brooklyn surgery is Wednesday. They're not even going to let Mama go in with her. That's what you get for growing up, sis. Yeah. Okay. Thank you. Yes, Becky. All right. Remember, Heather Keenan. I know most of y'all probably saw on Facebook. She just got out of the hospital. Was it yesterday? That's what I thought. Kathy, did you raise a hand?
Yeah.
Amen. We're going to line you and Sue up and race you pretty soon. They both had knee replacements the same day, different places. I want to share something with you all. I know you've prayed and you still continue to pray for Kirkwood, my grandson's adopted dad. They said Kirk could never walk again. And Friday, Christy posted a video on Facebook, and he was taking steps in a walker. One leg moving on his own, assistance from a PT person, but he's taking steps. And, folks, that's a miracle.
especially in view of what the medical personnel said. So keep praying and thank you for your prayers. Anybody else? Yes. All right. She was at one time, but yeah, all right, we'll put her. All right, Nora Taylor. Yeah, thank you. Anybody else? All right, let's pray over these and pray for one another. I know we have people here with unspoken requests, all right? Colin, lead our prayer for us, please, sir.
Lord, I thank you for letting us gather here today and opening our hearts to your word. Lord, I ask you to be with these on the prayer list. You know their needs. You know what they need, Lord. Lord, just help us celebrate, finish celebrating your son's birth, and help us towards the new year.
Yes.
In your name I pray.
Amen.